Blackstone Publishing presents The Wrong Murder, a John J. Malone mystery by Craig Rice. This book is read by Johnny Heller. Chapter 1. Later, they were able to trace the little man in the rusty black overcoat as far south as Van Buren Street. At an indeterminate point somewhere south of the corner of State and Van Buren, the trail was lost. Not that it mattered greatly, after the man was dead. His first appearance on State Street that could be proved beyond the shadow of a doubt was at the northwest corner of Van Buren, just below the steps leading to the elevated. He had paused there briefly to buy a newspaper. The newsstand boy remembered him clearly, especially the manner in which he had fished the depths of a worn leather change purse for the odd penny. When they found the little man later in the day, the newspaper was still tucked under his arm, unread, just as the boy had folded it. No one would have expected him to be noticed anywhere, especially not on State Street in the last week before Christmas. He was a trifle under the average height, stoop-shouldered and exceedingly thin. His skin, drawn tight over the bones of his sharp-featured face, had an unhealthy pallor. His eyes were so light a blue as to be almost colorless, protuberant and peering as the eyes of a fish. A few wisps of untidy gray hair showed under his dusty black derby. On the whole, he was an ordinary, inconspicuous little man. So it was amazing later, though not to Dan Von Flanagan of the Homicide Squad, how many people remembered seeing him on his progress up State Street after a photograph of his remains had appeared on the front page of the Times. It seemed almost as though everyone who had been on State Street that afternoon in the peak of the Christmas shopping rush had seen and noticed the little man in the rusty black overcoat. Nevertheless, it was from just such volunteered information that it was possible, later, to find out where the little man had gone and what he had done between Van Buren Street and the corner where his stroll had ended abruptly. It appeared that he had not been in a hurry. The newsstand boy was positive that it had been exactly 2:05 when the man stopped to buy a paper. He remembered it because his next customer had been a girl in a red hat who had asked him the time, and his watch, a present from his grandfather, was never wrong. There was no possible doubt that it was just 2:15 by the big clock over State and Madison Streets when the little man reached that corner. 100 witnesses were ready to swear to it. The distance between those two points was only 4 longish blocks, so his progress had been slow. Just north of Van Buren Street, he had paused before the Rialto Burlesque Theater to examine the colored posters that adorned its facade. Still farther in the same block, he had paused again before a window filled with inexpensive garments that could be purchased on convenient credit terms. At the corner of Jackson Boulevard, he had barely escaped being run down by an automobile, driven by a Mr. Lewis Whitman of Oak Park. The State Street sidewalks were jammed from wall to gutter with holiday shoppers. Lampposts were transformed with Christmas wreaths. Christmas decorations of every kind glittered in the windows. Chimes and amplified recordings of 12 different Christmas carols came from loudspeakers, each trying to outdo the other in volume. Salvation Army lassies and Volunteers of America Santa Clauses rang their little bells furiously on every corner. It appeared, however, that the man in the rusty black overcoat had no Christmas shopping to do. At least there was no evidence of his having done any. He did pause at the drugstore on the corner of State and Adams Street long enough to ask the soda fountain clerk for a little baking soda and a glass of carbonated water. The clerk, when questioned later, thought that it had been just about 2:00, perhaps a few minutes past. The little man emerged from the drugstore and stood for a moment in front of the doorway, jostled by the passing crowds, as though deciding which direction he should take. Then at last he appeared to make up his mind and plunged into the sea of holiday shoppers crossing Adams Street. Just beyond Adams Street, by the corner window of the fair store, there was an almost impenetrable pedestrian traffic jam. Evidently, the man hesitated an instant at the edge of the corner, watching the shoppers who were trying to fight their way up to the toy display in the window, and then decided to skirt the crowd by going out to the very last inch of sidewalk, instead of trying to push his way through. That may have been his second narrow escape of the afternoon. He went slowly past the fair store, past the little shops just south of Monroe Street, and past the big variety store on the corner, paying no attention to the extravagant displays in the windows. At the southwest corner of Monroe Street, he paused again, waiting for a traffic light to change. Beyond Monroe Street, he went more slowly, staying now on the inside edge of the sidewalk, pausing once or twice to stare reflectively at the display.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.